salt and water. So this particular solution is the one which does the compression activity. The reason for using this solution, salt solution in this system, is that it has a very good affinity towards water vapor, meaning that it is deliquescent in nature. It can absorb moisture and it can liquefy. So this particular property is being used in this system, and this affinity to water vapor improves or increases as the concentration of the solution increases, and is very good when the temperature is low. So these particular properties are utilized in designing the absorption. Now let us briefly try to understand how this equipment works. So for that we have to see all these four heat exchangers in close. We have to focus on that. So first heat exchanger being the evaporator. So the process fluid or the chilled water would come from the we can say the process or the air handling units if it is used for air conditioning, and it would come at a higher temperature, which would be circulated through the tubes of the evaporator. Now on top of the tubes we would be spraying this refrigerant, which is water. Now to have this entire system working, we have to maintain vacuum inside this chamber, because at this particular vacuum only the boiling of the refrigerant would take place, and the latent heat for this evaporation of the refrigerant is going to be derived from the chilled water, like in any conventional refrigeration or cooling systems. So we have the saturated liquid refrigerant which is sprayed on the evaporator tubes. Now when this water falls onto the tubes, there is a heat transfer taking place between the chilled water and the refrigerant, which would instantaneously evaporate the refrigerant. Due to this, the chilled water temperature reduces and it leaves the chiller at the required temperature and goes back to the process to pick up further heat. Now, when the refrigerant vapor is produced, there is a slight increase in the pressure inside this chamber. Now, for constant chilled water outlet temperature to be produced, we need to ensure that this vacuum levels are maintained constant. So, this is done by the next heat exchanger, which is called as the absorber. Now, what is the role of the absorber in this absorption system? So absorber is the one which maintains the vacuum inside the machine. So it maintains vacuum by absorbing the refrigerant vapor coming from the evaporator. So we spray a concentrated solution of lithium bromide in the absorber chamber. This lithium bromide solution at a higher concentration is hygroscopic in nature, which means that it has an affinity towards water vapor. When this water vapor is absorbed, the heat of dilution is released to the lithium bromide solution, which heats up the solution. Now, if the temperature of lithium bromide is increased, the affinity reduces. To overcome this, the cooling water is circulated through the tubes of the absorber, which takes away this heat of dilution. So this is one major area where it differs from the electrical systems, because there is going to be heat rejection in two heat exchangers. One is condenser and the other is the absorber. Now the cooling water takes away the heat of dilution, and this absorption process continues till the time the refrigerant vapor is absorbed by the solution and the lean solution is generated. Now this lean solution is unable to absorb any more water vapor because it has become saturated for this condition. Now how do we reconstruct or continue this process? For continuing this process, we have to separate this refrigerant and lithium bromide. And for this, the next step is to pump this lean solution into the generator section, where the heat source is used to heat the lithium bromide solution to its boiling point. Now, as the lithium bromide temperature rises and it reaches its boiling point, the refrigerant inside the lithium bromide solution evaporates or it vaporizes because of the difference in the boiling points of the salt and the refrigerant. So, refrigerant vapor is produced. Now, this refrigerant vapor is of no use to us unless it is converted into liquid refrigerant. So the process has to continue into the next heat exchanger, which is the condenser. But meanwhile, what happens is that since the refrigerant has been separated from the lithium bromide solution and its concentration is high, it can be put back into the absorber chamber. and this process can continue. A process of absorption can continue. Okay. So the as the refrigerant vapor gets separated, this vapor is transferred into the condenser, where it exchanges heat with the cooling tower water, and it gets condensed. And this liquid refrigerant is put back into the evaporator. So this is in a nutshell how the cycle gets completed. So evaporation, absorption, regeneration, and condensation are the four stages through which this absorption cycle passes. So once this liquid refrigerant is back and the concentrated solution is back, this process will continue in a cyclic manner. Now, what are the benefits of using an absorption chiller? So the most important aspect is that it can help the user save on operating cost and maintenance cost. It can also be very handy when you have waste heat available in your processes. So waste heat, if it is available, what happens is that the entire cost of operating this unit would be very, very less, maybe 90 to 95% less compared to a conventional compression unit. And since it uses a refrigerant which is water, it is very environment friendly product, and because it doesn't have maybe you can say energy consuming equipment like a compressor, so the power consumption is also relatively very low, something like 90 to 95% lower than a conventional compression unit of the same capacity. And there are not many moving parts. There are only small pumps for transferring the lithium bromide solution and the refrigerant, which don't cause any major concern from the wear and tear or noise or vibration point of view. Okay, now coming on to the different types of absorption unit, just to give an overview, we have absorption unit running on steam. Steam can be of different pressures. We have a single stage unit, single stage technology, which will be able to use steam starting with just above atmospheric pressure to a pressure of approximately 3 to 3.5 bar as the driving heat source, and capacity ranges are from 50 to 3500 PR. So what is important to note would be the specific steam consumption. To produce one unit of refrigeration or one USRT, you would require approximately 6.7 to 7 kilograms of steam per hour. Now when you go to the two stage absorption unit, you will notice that the steam pressure requirement here is higher than the single stage, and because we are using a higher grade of energy, which is maybe steam at maybe 6 to 8 bar pressure, this unit gives you a lower steam consumption. You can see it is literally half that of a single stage chiller, and the COP of this unit is double that of the single stage unit. So that type of technology used is dependent on the energy source that is available, is the temperature and pressure. Now when you have very high pressure of steam available, then we can go for a three stage absorption chiller as well. The further reduction in steam consumption can be noticed here, where the steam consumption is less than 3 kilograms per hour per year. And what can be produced out of an absorption unit with this this heat source is that we can generate water, chilled water down up to 1 degree Celsius, pure water at 1 degree Celsius, or if glycol solutions are used, we can go up to minus 5 degree Celsius using the conventional lithium bromide absorption. And certain applications would demand a high delta T in the chilled water, something like ambient water getting cooled to 7 or 5 or lower temperatures. So absorption technology can handle temperature differences in chilled water as high as 30 degrees Celsius. So ambient water to 5 degrees Celsius is also possible. So we will just touch upon one unique application of absorption unit, where you can understand the heat recovery angle of absorption units. So this is an application on a potato fryer. So potato has around 70 to 75% moisture in it. So when potato is fried in a fryer, you would have noticed even in your kitchen, when you are frying something, the water content inside the product evaporates upon frying, and then water is water vapor is lost into the atmosphere. So when you look at large maybe potato fryer systems, which are operated by maybe you can say the snacks manufacturers, you can imagine the kind of maybe vapor which is coming out of this fryers. So conventionally, these vapors are let out into the atmosphere, which causes two harms. One is you are letting out heat at a high temperature, and it is going unutilized. And second thing is that what is going out is nearly pure water vapor, nearly, because it may have traces of oil, but it is water that is going out as vapor into the atmosphere. Now, how this problem can be solved is by introducing an absorption chiller in between, where the vapor from the fryer can be taken into an absorption unit, where it will be condensed inside the generator, and you can recover that heat to produce cooling. Now, like in any industry, there are maybe you can say air conditioning requirements in the in snack industry as well, where you have to maintain a particular temperature and humidity level in the packaging unit to ensure that there is the crispiness of the chips are not lost. So for that, this chilled water can be utilized. So which becomes like you are generating wealth from waste. The waste heat going out in the form of vapor is now able to generate the, and meet the cooling demands of the application. So this recovers water in this process, which can be once you treat the water, you can use it as a makeup water for your other applications, like cleaning the potatoes, or maybe even for as a makeup water for the cooling towers. So it becomes a very sustainable solution for such kind of an industry. So it can help them reduce the carbon footprint as well as become a zero discharge kind of application. So to give a brief of this, 1500 kgs of chips when it is produced, the potential recovery is nearly 500 tons of cooling and 3.5 meter cube per hour of water. So that is a huge saving for the industry. And such installations have been operational for last so many years, and maybe they are available in various capacities. These are finding traction in such a heat recovery application. Now, as I mentioned, the hot water also can be used as a heat source for absorption unit. So hot water like steam can be also available in various temperatures. So when you have hot water temperatures 80 degrees and above, we can use an absorption chiller which is of single stage to generate cooling. Capacity ranges can be something like 15 TR to 3500 TR. And another important point to be noted is that today there are technologies available which can utilize water at temperatures lower than 80 degrees Celsius as well. So such technologies are gaining popularity as the energy cost is increasing, and there is a continued focus on maybe you can say reducing the carbon footprint or reducing the operational expenses. So such technologies are also available. But as a standard unit, what is available in the market would be something like single stage chillers for 80 degrees Celsius and above. When you have higher hot water temperatures like 150 degrees Celsius and above, you can go for either a two stage or a three stage chiller. And the same, the chilled water that is can be generated is of the same order. You can generate 1 degree water or -5 degree brine with higher delta T's. So I would like to share one interesting application where you can put such a hot water chiller to use. There are screw compressors or air compressors use in many industries for generating instrument air or process air requirements. So such compressors, there is a heat which gets generated during this compression process, which is typically rejected into the atmosphere using radiators. So this heat is having a potential to be also considered as a heat for running the absorption unit. So what can be done is this heat from the maybe the intermediate circuit, which is there is a oil which is circulated, which is removing this heat from this air. This oil can be put through a heat exchanger and you can generate hot water up to 75 or 80 degrees Celsius. And this hot water can be effectively used in an absorption unit to produce cooling. So one such case I would like to showcase here is in a tire industry, where there are a battery of compressors put to use, and the tire industry also requires a lot of cooling in various locations for spot cooling etc. So what is done is this heat from the compressor is captured as hot water, and that hot water is put through an absorption unit to generate chilled water. And it can easily meet the air conditioning demand of the industry. Even if it is not the full demand, at least it can help to offset a part of the cooling demand and reduce power. And also, you are reducing the heat rejected to the environment, which is going as waste. Here, it is doing some useful work, and then it is getting discharged. So another opportunity for wealth creation from waste. There is a growing demand, as you would have read in the newspapers. There is a high data traffic which is happening during this COVID lockdown across the globe. So data centers are in high demand, and it would be interesting to note that data centers are applications which require very high quality and high reliability of power and cooling. So power is required to run the servers which store the data and transmit the data, and the cooling is required to keep the temperatures of these servers within an optimum band. So cooling as well as power are very critical to data centers. So the most sought after type of solution for data centers is CCHP, or combined cooling, heating and power, wherein what is done is there is a gas engine or a gas turbine which is put to generate power, which can cater to the power demand of the data center, so that it can work in an island mode free from any grid disturbances. And the waste heat which is generated from this gas engines or gas turbines can be used to generate free cooling using absorption unit. So one such data center I have just mentioned here is able to cater to a large percentage of their cooling demand, and it gives them a self-sufficiency by both in terms of power as well as cooling. And since it is recovering waste heat to generate cooling, it also gives a green aspect to such data centers. Okay, so the third variety of heat source, which we discussed in the beginning, are direct fired units and exhaust driven units. So when we say direct fired units, where we talk about units which can fire natural gas or diesel or LPG or biogas and produce cooling. So the heat from the combustion of the gas or the oil is converted into heat to heat the lithium bromide solution directly. So it becomes the simplest form of energy source for an absorption unit. If the economics work out well, so it can be used for commercial air conditioning as well. Shopping malls or maybe office complexes also can use direct fired absorption unit, which is a very popular way of doing air conditioning in various countries where there is gas available across the country. And if gas is not available directly, or gas is available but it is not not viable enough to run a direct fired unit, the next best option is to go for an exhaust gas driven unit, where the exhaust gas could be delivered from the engine, which will be used for power generation. So, before we go on to that, there are applications where industries as well as in commercial applications like maybe supermarkets or commercial buildings or maybe even in apartments, housing colonies also can make use of such absorption units. Okay, so what is CHPP or CHPC? Or what is CCHP? It is nothing but a way of efficiently meeting cooling, heating and power demands by using natural gas as the driving source. Most probably natural gas, because that is a clean form of fossil, at least the cleaner form of fossil fuel. So natural gas can be put into an engine which can generate power. Power can be used for captive requirements or for even to be delivered to the grid. And the waste heat which is coming out from this engine in the form of exhaust gas or the hot water coming from the engine jacket can be used to drive an absorption unit, So if the heating demand is higher, it can be also maybe thought of convert. We can also think of converting part of this heat into maybe steam or hot water, or maybe we can use it entirely for running the absorption unit which delivers the cooling units. So there is a lot of flexibility in this kind of a system where, based on your power, cooling, and heating requirements, you can balance the load. What is the advantage absorption technology brings to this concept is that the efficiency of typical gas engines are in the range of 40 to 45%, and there are maybe engines which are slightly higher in efficiency as well. But in a nutshell, the efficiency is not attractive enough to any layman. So how somebody can make it more attractive is by doing heat recovery, where by putting an absorption unit and doing the heat recovery, you can probably increase the efficiency to as high as 90%. So which is very high considering the conventional fossil fuel based centralized power plants, which have hardly 30 to 40% the overall efficiency. So compared to that, this system can be much more efficient and much more greener. Okay, so you can meet the cooling and heating demands virtually free of cost. So one such large installation you can see on the screen, where a 5.2 megawatt gas turbine is used to generate the power required for a large office complex, government office complex. And the flue gas from the turbine is split into two parts, and each is fed to one absorption chiller each, so that they can deliver the chilled water which can be used for air conditioning of the office building. So such projects are very well established, and nowadays none of the turbines are working on in an open cycle kind of configuration. Many times it is coupled with an absorption unit to recover the heat to the maximum possible extent. Okay, so this is what an engine-based heat recovery system would look like. You have the engine, you have a three-way diverter valve to control the flue gas into the chiller or out of the chiller. We can make use of the engine jacket water, as well as there can be a provision given to fire natural gas in the so that in the absence of the engine in operation, or the exhaust gas or the jacket water are less in heat value due to part load engine operation, we can still achieve the full heating requirement or cooling requirement by firing natural gas. So this is what the system looks like. So this system has been put to practice in maybe you can say applications which are in the commercial segment as well as the industrial segment. So there are, for your information, there are hospitals maybe in India as well as abroad, where the entire power demand of the hospital is derived from gas gensets, and the cooling demand is also partially catered by the absorption unit. So that virtually the hospital can be independent of the grid, or it can be an island mode wherein it is able to take care of its energy demands by itself. So there is a lot of energy savings, there is a lot of CO2 emission reduction, etc., which is also an accrued benefit for the youth. So these are certain critical applications. So now in the industrial segment also there are applications. For example, this is one case that there is this plastic toy manufacturer who uses the CHPC concept to generate power for his plant operations, and the waste heat is converted into chilled water, which is used for cooling the injection molds, in which the plastic is pushed through to generate the toys. So maybe in every industry there is some requirement of cooling or the other, which can be catered efficiently by this kind of a CHPC technology. Okay, so far we have been seeing the cooling aspect of this absorption technology. Now there is this heating aspect to this technology as well. So what is interesting to note is that there are two types of heat pumps which are possible with this absorption technology. We call it as the type 1 heat pump and the type 2 heat pump, or the heat transformer. So they can be used for low and medium medium temperature heating in industries as well as for case keeping applications in cold countries. And what this technology brings to the table is a lot of there is a huge energy saving potential which this technology has, which we will see as we move forward. So this type 1 heat pump can be used to generate hot water up to 90 degrees Celsius. What can be used as a heat source is any of the heat source that we discussed, which can drive the absorption technology. And it can utilize waste heat. Waste heat can be in the form of cooling tower water or geothermal water or some water which is rejected from the processes. Maybe engine jacket water or flue gas condensation heat. So any form of low-grade waste heat is there. We can use it in an absorption heat pump to generate medium temperature hot water. So just to illustrate the energy saving aspect of this heat pump, look at a conventional system where you want to generate hot water at 90 degrees Celsius using steam. So typically in industries, what people do is to put a small heat exchanger and they would pass steam on one side and pass the hot water on the other side and generate heat. But in this system, for every kilowatt of heat that you give to steam, you get equal or slightly less heating on the hot water side. So it is having something like a maybe you can say it is giving 1 kilowatt for 1 kilowatt of heating. Now, when you compare this with a heat pump system, absorption heat pump system, for every 1 kilowatt energy that you consume, you get 40% higher energy in the form of 90 degree hot water. So how does this happen? So this technology, what it does is it recovers heat from low grade, it recovers heat from high grade, and it combines these two and delivers heat at medium grade. So the low grade heat becomes waste heat, it becomes the waste heat source, which is reducing the consumption of the live heat source, which is the steam in this case. So you can for same 1 kilowatt of heating, producing 1 kilowatt of heating, you virtually require, or you actually require only 0.6 kilowatt of heat from steam. Remaining 0.4 kilocalories is coming from the waste source. So there is 40% reduction in steam consumption, which is a huge savings if you consider 6,000 to 8,000 hours of operation of the equipment. So this kind of heat pumps are very well used in a lot of applications, including simpler applications like boiler feed water heating, or process hot water requirements, etc. One application I would like to mention here is an application in automobile industry where you have paint booths or you have parkerizing systems where you need to have hot water circulated through the system to maintain the temperature of the paint or to maintain the chemical temperature so that the process happens. So typically in automobile industries, they go for clean fuels like natural gas or propane or LPG, because any usage of solid fuel or liquid fuel can lead to a lot of suspended particles which can hamper the quality of their product. The paint which comes out on the unit can get damaged because of that. So when you use such a clean fuel and the cost of the fuel is very high, literally a large amount of money is spent in just maintaining this paint booth system. So an absorption heat pump can be an efficient solution for this kind of a paint booth system, wherein we have seen solutions like absorption heat pumps recovering heat from cooling towers or from their other processes, and delivering an energy reduction or reduction in fuel consumption by around 40%. So the user saves on costly fuel, which is natural gas, diesel, or natural gas, propane, or diesel in certain cases. And the savings can be in crores of rupees, depending upon the scale of operation. So just to illustrate, I'll just mention a brief calculation of a scenario with the heat pump and without the heat pump for a 10 lakh kilocalorie heating requirement. So what the heat pump delivers is the same 10 lakh kilocalorie, but the consumption of the fuel is worth only 6 lakh kilocalories. And 4 lakh kilocalories is the heat which is recovered from cooling tower water. So dual benefits, one is savings in fuel, which is easily quantifiable. And second is the savings in cooling tower heat losses or cooling tower water losses by evaporation, because we are effectively using that heat to run the absorption unit. So wherein you can save something like for 10 lakh kilocalories, considering the gas to be available at approximately 30 rupees a cubic meter, you can save approximately 1 crore worth of operational expense, and you would save a lot of water, 52 lakh liters of water per year in terms of the cooling tower losses. So this is a huge saving for any industry, and the savings are valuable in any industry in this current scenario. So this can be used as a maybe solution to reduce your operating expenses. What are the other applications for such heat pumps? If you look at maybe you can say older countries, for their space heating requirements, they have district heating power plants, district heating plants where they centrally generate the hot water and it is circulated to the system of piping across the city, and they give the heating to the individual users. Now most of these district heating plants are run on the back of waste incineration technologies, where the municipal waste or the solid waste which is coming out of their town is incinerated, and the flue gas from that is converted into steam, and before it is let out in the stack, the flue gas, the moisture content in the flue gas is condensed, and that heat is fed to the absorption unit. So literally, if you see the stack temperature, in most of the cases is close to 40 degrees Celsius or below. So the maximum amount of heat that is recovered is pushed or is pulled back into the entire system. It can be to generate power, or it can be to generate heating. It is also tackling the problem of solid waste. So effective utilization. So what can be looked at for country like India is instead of district heating, it makes a lot of sense to go for district cooling as a concept on back of this solid waste incineration technology. So when you have waste heat available in the form of flue gas or steam, you can recover that and run absorption units, which can effectively convert this heat into heating or cooling, and you gain more or you generate more output than the input heat. And in this particular case, the unit works as a chiller in summer and as a heat pump in winter, catering to both the demands using one single equipment. So that is the beauty of this technology. Okay, so similar thing can be done on maybe you can say engine-based power plants, where you don't require any cooling. At least you can convert the waste heat into heating, and rather than putting maybe heat recovery units, if you use an absorption heat pump, as I mentioned, that this heat pump can generate 40% more output for the same heat available in the flue gas. And in one such case, we have been able to achieve the overall thermal efficiency of 103% because of the recovery of heat from the moisture in the flue gas. So the flue gas condensation with that system, we are able to increase the efficiency above 100%. Okay, now looking at the second type of absorption heat pump, it is a different concept, where if you have waste heat as a source at a medium temperature, you can upgrade part of that heat to higher temperature. So that is the name, heat transformer. It is like a step up transformer, which actually steps up the voltage in electrical parlance. Here it converts the heat from low temperature or medium temperature to a higher temperature. So you can look at this example, where you have waste heat at 90 degrees Celsius. You are supposed to cool it to 80 degrees Celsius. So this heat, if you feed into an absorption heat pump or an absorption heat transformer, you can convert nearly 45 to 50% of heat and generate the hot water at higher temperatures, something like 130 to 140 degrees Celsius. And the remaining only needs to be rejected to the atmosphere. So 50% is the potential recovery, and the recovery is not at lower temperatures but at higher temperatures. That makes the proposition more sweet, because many industries have heating requirements which are higher in temperature, where the waste heat may not be of any use. So you can upgrade the heat to higher temperatures by using a heat transformer and still recover at least a sizable chunk of the waste heat. So 46 to 50% is the recovery potential. So this is one such food processing unit where they require hot water at 120 to 130 degrees Celsius for cooking of noodles and pasta. So what is done is they have a CHPC system which generate hot water at 90 degrees Celsius, and that heat is used put through a type 2 heat pump or a heat transformer, and the required hot water is generated at 130 to 135 degrees Celsius. So overall there is a reduction in energy and also the reduction in the losses of heat to the environment. Proceed further, as I mentioned, this technology is mostly thought of as a solution for temperatures above 5 degrees Celsius, but that is not the real case. This technology can be expanded on either side. On the heating side, we have just seen. Similarly, we can also extend it in the lower ranges where you can generate, maybe you can say, sub-zero temperatures even using this kind of hands-off. So this is industries like dairy, edible oil, food and beverages, pharma, chemicals, etc. And what it saves is a lot of lower temperatures. What happens is that the compressor power consumption keeps on increasing as the temperature keeps on increasing. So we can make use of absorption technology. We can make use of waste heat to generate the same cooling requirements. So this is one such application wherein an aerated drinks manufacturer for their process. They need to for ensuring the proper absorption of carbon dioxide in the aerated drink, they need to maintain the temperature lower. So that is achieved by using an absorption unit which generates brine at minus 2 degrees Celsius, which is going to cool the syrup as well as between other applications. So what it does is it uses in this particular case steam from a biomass boiler. So the steam is available at low cost, and it is able to generate brine at minus 2 degrees Celsius. Thereby, there is a savings of approximately 150 kilowatt of power. So there is a huge saving for a sizable aerated drink. So this was a negative cooling using a standard absorption technology. Now, in the positive temperatures, again, in many applications, you will come across the use of glycols. Because as you are operating closer to the freezing point of water, generally, the recommendation from the manufacturers or from the consultants are that you should use glycol solutions. So, glycol solutions are detrimental in two ways. One is it is having lower heat transfer properties. So the size of the equipment increases. At the same time, what also happens is that these glycols are expensive in nature and also corrosive in nature. And some of the glycols are toxic in nature. So when you are using such a glycol solution in food industry, it becomes very difficult for the user. So high level of design expertise is required to tackle such cases. So what is also possible now with absorption technology is that you can generate water at 1 degree Celsius directly from the absorption. So you can in a way avoid all the intermediate circuits, generation of low temperature primes, glycol solutions, etc. And you can simply use the still water at 1 degree Celsius directly into the process without any fear of contamination or toxicity. So that is this aspect. So these are called as 1 degree water chillers, where heat source is the same. Whatever is that we have discussed earlier can be used as the heat source, and you can generate water, pure water at up to 1 degree Celsius as the output. So this is the conventional system versus what 1 degree water can do. So conventional systems generate lower refrigerant temperatures at minus 5 or minus 10 degrees Celsius and store energy in an ice bank tank for usage later. So this can be easily replaced with a 1 degree water system which is continuously operating. So you can, in the second system, you can see that there is an intermediate circuit which is put in place. So you can avoid the secondary power consumption, the secondary heat exchanger, etc. And you can make the system very simple. Okay, another variety, or another possibility with the absorption technology is by combining it with compression technology. So this is called as a hybrid chiller, wherein you have a compressor and you have an absorption unit, wherein we can generate low temperatures using the compressor, and we use VAM as the heat rejection media for the compression unit. So this can effectively reduce the power consumption of the compressor by nearly 15%. Okay, so you can see in this illustration that the savings is power savings to the tune of approximately 50%, which is very high. It can use waste heat as a driving media for the absorption unit. Waste heat can be hot water or maybe low pressure steam or exhaust gas, or even we can say thermal oil can be used as the driving source for such hybrid units. So sizable reduction in power consumption and usage of waste heat makes it very valuable proposition. So one such scenario, if you look at if you have a 100 TR refrigeration department and temperature is from -5 to -10, so you would save maybe you can say a lot on the operating cost, which across the maybe 1 year of operation can deliver you savings of in lakhs of rupees. And savings goes higher and higher as the temperature of the prime goes lower and lower. So this is what we have seen is either cooling system or heating system. Now we look at a combination system wherein an absorption unit can produce both chilled water and hot water at the same time. And by doing so, it can save approximately 23% of energy. So this is called as a high efficiency chiller heater, which is also a very popular, as well as a, maybe you can say, kind of a norm in certain industries, wherein the user can cater to his cooling and heating requirements simultaneously using one unit, and also save a substantial amount of energy. So just to illustrate that, we can generate chilled water at up to 1 degree Celsius, or glycols at even -2 degree Celsius, and generate hot water simultaneously at approximately 90 degree Celsius. And if you see conventional system versus this energy efficient system, you can see that conventional system would require, let's say, 770 kilograms for generating, let's say, 100 TR of cooling, and approximately 260 kilowatt of heat. The same output can be generated by this energy efficient solution with just 600 kg of steam, which is literally 23% lower steam consumption. So what it brings brings to the table is a single unit. You don't have to maintain multiple units to cater to your cooling and heating requirements. And at the same time, you are getting a sizable savings. This savings can be saving in steam or savings in fuel if it is a direct fired unit. And you can make use of this in both industrial context as well as in commercial application, like in hotels and hospitals. Okay, so one such illustration, there is a 5-star hotel where it's a 170 room 5-star hotel. It's a resort where this kind of a concept has been successfully implemented for the last so many years, where there is a 450 TR chiller with a heating module attached to it. So the steam is given from a biomass boiler, which makes it more greener. And we can cater to both the cooling demand and heating demand simultaneously. Cooling is used for air conditioning, and the heating is can be used for maybe laundry or for a spa or those kind of applications. So the same thing can be replicated in an industrial context, or in context of hospitals or in pharma industry, etc., where there is a high demand for cooling as well as heating simultaneously. So dairy, pharma, chemical industries, etc., form an ideal fit for this kind of energy efficiency. So that was all from the presentation side. So thank you for patient hearing. I hope this session will have given you a lot of insights, and I think we can now open the floor for question and answers. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Mr. Vaidyanathan. It was a very interesting and informative presentation. Our participants has left out some questions in the chat box. Yeah. I request you to pick up their questions and answer them.
Okay. I'll just give me a moment. Okay, so I can see a lot of questions in this. Okay, so there is a question on series flow and paraflow technology. So these are just maybe you can say the different types of technologies used within the absorption domain for handling the lithium bromide solution. So this kind of divisions in the technology is not what is the theme of today's seminar. But I would like to tell you, so irrespective of this technology, we can make use of absorption as a means for heat recovery. So the type of technology is the choice of the user or the choice of the manufacturer. So that is what I would like to say. So what kind of heat exchanger is used as condenser? So typically these are shell and tube heat exchangers, which is forming the condenser, the evaporator and the absorber and the generators. Somebody has a question, is it shell and tube type or plate type? So yes, the condensers are shell and tube type heat exchangers. But the internal heat exchangers can be either shell and tube or plate type depending upon the manufacturer's choice. What is the quality of water required in the absorber? So water quality from that particular aspect, maybe soft water is what is required or desired by the system. But of course, we have seen that many industries may have a challenge in maintaining a good quality water in the cooling towers because of various constraints. So water quality issues can be to a large extent handled by changing the metallurgy used in the cooling water or the chilled water circuit. Depending upon the water quality, we can look at the various metallurgies like copper, cupronickel, stainless steel, duplex steel, titanium, etc. So it is each case can be looked at from that aspect. One is the quality of water, then secondly, what is the economic solution for that? What will be the approximate temperature of vapor coming out from the regenerator? So the temperature of vapor depends on the heat source. And the technology that is being used. So it will vary from maybe something like 80 to 90 degrees Celsius to 150 degrees to 160 degrees Celsius as well. So it depends on the technology. Next question is, if waste heat is not available, then is it a good idea to replace VCM with RAM? Yeah, so even in case you don't have a